Which power word interrupts your normal brain function and decision making? Find out the surprising answer in today's episode. Speak with strength and grow strong. How words shape reality. Greetings everyone, Mazen here. Welcome to the Maxima Life. Have you ever heard that old saying, choose your words wisely? This phrase is typically used to warn a person of the impact their words choices can have on other people. But in reality, the greater impact of our word choices is on us and not on the people around us. We speak to ourselves more than we will ever speak to anyone else in the world. Our mind hears our words and immediately sets the course to make those words our reality. It doesn't matter if those words are bad or good, false or true, negative or positive. Our minds will respond with intention to bring our words into action. If I were to put you into a functional MRI scanner, a huge donut-shaped magnet that can capture detailed images of the neural changes happening in your brain in real time, and now if I just flash the word no before your eyes for less than 1 second, the scanner would show a sudden release of dozens of stress-producing hormones and neurotransmitters. These chemicals instantly interrupt the normal function of the brain. The result is impaired logic, fear-based reasoning, and stunned communication. Anything we repeatedly say gradually convinces our minds to alter our reality to make what we say become true. The more you repeat negative words and thoughts, the more likely you are to experience sleep disturbances, appetite irregularity, anxiety, and irritability. The brain is a bank. We can only withdraw what we deposit. Our brains perceive a reality, and we can only perceive what we believe to be possible. Here is another old saying you're probably familiar with. Seeing is believing. But now we know that how we see the world is a matter of choice. Ultimately, it comes down to options. The feelings of not having any options is almost always self-imposed. It's a mindset perpetuated by negative self-talk and cultural conditioning. We always have options when we choose to see them. Do we opt to see problems or challenges, threats or advantages and adventures, obstacles or opportunities, setbacks or progress, failures or valuable lessons? The language that we choose reinforces our perception of reality. How we perceive reality shapes and determines the course of our entire lives. When you frame your situation from a negative perspective, you blind yourself from seeing the gifts and possibilities that open up any time we experience any kind of change. Negative language belies our ability to reap valuable insights from our mistakes. The difference between a victim and a victor has nothing to do with circumstances. It is all a matter of mindset. A loss can always be perceived as a win if you're open to experiencing life as a continuous process of learning, enthusiastically seizing every opportunity to extract valuable insight that will propel you in exciting ways you cannot always foresee. I'm reminded of a friend from college who I witnessed go through a really difficult breakup. At the time of graduation, my friend already has a promising job in his field of study, and he's living in a great apartment right in the center of a lively and vibrant community. His fiancée still has about 2 years left before she graduates, and they decide it's easier for him to find a new job than for her to transfer schools. So he quits his job and leaves his beloved neighborhood to be closer to her college. They moved in to a beautiful, big place that they can only afford together, and things between them almost immediately begin to go off the rails. Now that they are around each other full-time, they become apparent that they are not as compatible as they once believed. After only 6 months of living together, my friend and his fiancé are at a crossroads. The difference becomes irreconcilable when he discovers that she's been dating someone else. So he calls me to talk about his situation. Here are some of the things that he said. I lost my apartment. I lost my job. I gave up everything I had to be with her. Now I have to start over. I've been staying on my friend's couch like a loser. She ruined my life. She wasted my life. There are all common grievances when someone is going through a breakup. And I hear him out patiently as he repeats these grievances several times over the course of several phone calls. Eventually, the calls stop. And a few months pass before I hear from him again. As soon as he says hello, I can hear a difference in his voice. I can tell he's doing better. I remember thinking, maybe the two of them worked things out and they got back together. What I discover is that he's still looking for steady work and staying with friends, but his attitude has changed. I asked him, what caused such a major shift in his outlook? And he told me that before he found himself in this crisis, he had never realized how many people he had in his life that really care about him. He was so touched by how many friends immediately reached out and offered to share time and resources with him until he was able to get back on track, that it felt so selfish to continue bemoaning his circumstances surrounding his ex. And then he said something I will never forget. He said, the story I was telling myself about her and what happened to me was not even true. It just seemed true at the time because it complemented my pain. Wow. Are you asking yourself, where in my life am I telling myself stories that aren't necessarily true? That is a powerful question to ask. As it turns out, he did not lose his apartment. He had the option to sublet it for an entire year, and he chose to let it go. He did not lose his job. He had been feeling like he wanted to quit for some time because of hostile management. He did not ruin his life and have to start all over. He took a risk, learned a valuable lesson, and was making a fresh start with new eyes. His circumstances had not changed, but he had changed his mind and how he speaks about his circumstances. Today, my friend is happily married and the CEO of a very lucrative business that he co-founded with one of the friends that who had stayed with while he was recovering from that breakup. Let's get real right here, right now. Negative language is the byproduct of only one source, fear. You can see it in those we know who we always find a way to put a negative spin on life. We can feel it in ourselves when we flood our systems with stress hormones as a result of dwelling up on worst-case scenarios. It helped me to think of fear as the acronym false evidence appearing real. When we find ourselves in the face of challenging situations, and we all have our share, the words we use to describe that situation will directly determine how long we find ourselves lingering in these situations. Intense emotions such as anger, frustration, discomfort, and pain will produce narratives in our minds to support themselves. This is false evidence. The feelings are appearing real and often relatable and understandable. But in this case, feelings aren't facts. If you do not fuel negative emotions with a supporting narrative, then negativity will dissipate. Reality exists whether we fuel it or not. How long we are immersed in these difficult emotions that place a negative spin on everything depend on how long we tell ourselves the stories that support them. We can either support these feelings with false evidence of failure and defeat, or we can ease them with the thoughts of gratitude and determination. Our brains accept our words as truth, regardless of reality. The words we use determine how we feel. The superstar business people that I've coached are among the most high-spirited people I've ever met. The language they use reflects their devotion to being onward and upward moving. They wouldn't dream of calling a setback a problem. They would call it an opportunity, a stepping stone to create something even greater. And then, as if by magic, their positive language provokes a set of positive sensations within them that positions them correctly as winners. You would never catch them emotionally draining their team with blame or harsh criticism. Rather, they prefer winning words that inspire those around them to live in possibility and stay focused on the bigger picture. Maximal achiever Leonard Cohen says, "Act the way you'd like to be, and soon you'll be the way you act." Here are the tactics for speaking your strength. Build yourself up. The moment you speak something, you create an idea. You plant a seed that will eventually grow into a result. Use your words to change your situation, not to describe it. You can be the champion of your own mind by carefully guarding your language from any negative self-talk. When a friend asks you how business is coming along, you have a choice. Whether to respond with listing all the reasons why it's been difficult, which is not only brings you down, but it brings your friend down too. Or you can list all the things you feel good about and reinforce your passion for what you do. We do not need to be perfect when practicing this technique. Progress is more important than perfection. Choosing a positive position when talking about yourself instead of negatively venting your frustrations or highlighting the difficulties can change your physical and mental state. What matters most is that we are using your words to plant seeds of success rather than defeat. The next time you're feeling frustrated and a friend asks you how you're doing, be your own champion. Build yourself up. Next, power position your words. Most people do not realize how amazingly powerful their words can be, and they often choose neutral and automatic words that have no power at all. We hear it every day. Hey, how are you doing? Not too bad. How's your day going? Hanging in there. The next time someone asks you how your day is going, try responding with strength. Bring positive energy to otherwise mundane interaction. Reply with an intentional and enthusiastic, terrific, or I'm seizing the day. Even if you're having a challenging day, you can still respond with strength. You can choose to say, it's a challenging day, but I'm going to end it with a win. Be sincere, and you'll find it hard not to smile when you're speaking with strength. Be enthusiastic, and you'll find it hard to stay in a negative headspace. Use your words of strength to curate your mood. Your subconscious mind is listening and taking cues from the words you see. And you're using. Your reality is designed to be consistent with your thoughts and words. When others use words that seek to sap your energy, power position your words so that every response builds you back up, back into your strength. Build a strong vocabulary that reinforces positive energy and good mental connections. This will bring out the best in you and the best people around you. Now, let's discover the third instrument for speaking your strength. Presuppose positive outcomes. The quickest way to change the answers you receive from yourself and from the other people around you is to change the way you're asking the question. Ask questions that presuppose positive outcomes. And instead of asking yourself, how will I ever get through this situation? Ask, what is the best way for me to resolve this successfully? Beware of victim speak. The other day, I was in line at a coffee shop. And when the guy in front of me found out that they were out of caramel latte, he looked like someone had ran over his dog. Seriously, I wish if he could see his face. He replied to the barista, man, how can you do this to me? I thought he was joking. He wasn't. No matter what life sends us, whether it's a major challenge or a minor inconvenience, we are responsible for the ways we respond. Asking better questions create better options. Using victim speak creates the illusion that there aren't any options. When speaking to another person, the questions you ask will determine how involved, receptive, and motivated the other person will feel. So instead of asking a team member, why are we falling short of this month's sales goal, which elicits defensiveness and detachment, try instead asking, what do you think we can do to ensure we meet our sales goal? Your team member can feel engaged, involved, consulted, rather than insulted. The power of the answers you receive in life are directly proportionate to the questions you ask. Eugene Ionesco once said, it is not the answer that enlightens, but the question. The words you use directly and powerfully influence the life you live. Select them wisely. I have a little exercise to offer you that is definitely worth doing. Listen to yourself carefully throughout an entire day and notice the words you automatically choose. Do not judge yourself too harshly through this process. You're always in a state of continuous growth and in also a state of progress. Just take an impartial inventory of the words you choose. At the end of the day, make a list of the top 10 words you most frequently use and identify which of these words are not serving you in living the maximal life. Once you've clearly highlighted some words that aren't serving you, make a new list. This list will replace those words with stronger and more energetic and more positive word choices. Articulate a series of fantastically positive words that will serve you. You will find speaking these replacement words will make you feel better, more energetic, more powerful, more passionate, more positive. And when you feel these amazing feelings, you will do amazing things. Thank you all for joining me today. It is always a pleasure to explore and discover new insights and powerful techniques. We learn together how to be more fully, to step up to the challenging and exciting roles of leaders and champions as we continue to progress in living the maximal life. If you like what you have seen and heard, please subscribe.